Good afternoon and welcome to the Groveland Council on Aging's annual Older Americans Day, where we celebrate you and the good things that you're able to make with your hands. When you have an opportunity after the program today, please enjoy some of the beautiful artwork that's been shared with the residents of Groveland. Got some gorgeous quilts, some gorgeous watercolors, acrylics, oils, colored pencils, just some beautiful work. We also would like to introduce you to our speaker this afternoon. His name is Gus Roush. He is a Haverhill resident. He is a Haverhill treasure who's kindly sharing his gifts with us today. Please welcome Gus Roush.
Thank you very much. I'm glad to be here today. I don't have to be outside working at home. My wife, I got away from that. I was a teacher in Haverhill for over 40 years. I taught 6th, 7th, and 8th grade in public and parochial school. And I'm now the curator of the John Greenleaf Whittier Birthplace in Haverhill. And I've been doing that for 7 years. And if you've never been into the 326-year-old home, you're missing a treasure. Really, it's wonderful inside there. So all you have to do is come down there and say, you were here today, and I'll give you a free tour. But don't tell my bosses. I have been coming to Groveland for quite a few years now. And for the men's breakfast and the women's tea, and this is different today. This is nice. There's a mixed bag out here. Male and female, that's great. My forgetter is getting better than my rememberer. I'll be 80 in August, and I'm still going into the schools, and I teach the history of Haverhill. I teach the history of Bradford, and Groveland used to be East Bradford. Hope you remember that. Long time ago. Okay. Someone just asked me if I had the state police trooper with the little boy, because it's not up there. Well, I have these here. Oh. This is part of my speech. So some of these have a little story behind them. That's what makes them really interesting. Oh, he's in here. He's in here. So I don't want anyone to get panic stricken. Okay. This is a little introduction about Norman Rockwell, because sometimes people know his art, they love the art, but they don't know much about a person. And Norman Rockwell was a very complex individual, really. That's because he was a perfectionist, first of all, was never satisfied with whatever he did. And he had a very different life, and I'll get into that in a minute. People who thought they knew him never knew him. They just didn't. They couldn't. There was a lot going on in here. This is some of his background. First of all, he had three wives. Three. All teachers. All teachers. His first wife married Irene O'Connor when he was only 22. 22. She was 25. She wanted to get around the world with his money. That lasted 14 years, and she divorced him. Shortly after that, he married Mary Bostow. He was 36, she was only 22. Whoa, he's going the other way now. They had three children, Jarvis, or Jerry. He was born in 1932. He became a sculptor. And some of you who have been out to the museum, you've seen his sculpture out there. Then there was Tommy, 1933. He wrote children's books. And Peter, 1936, he became a bookstore owner and an artist. Norman's wife, Mary, eventually felt excluded from his life. This is the sad part. He was so busy all the time that she felt excluded, and it affected her greatly. She became a heavy drinker. and she died early in life and is listed as a coronary factor, but other people think that's not what really happened and there was no autopsy. And it's kind of sad. She was a very nice person from all that I have read, but she just felt left out. She's too busy. People who are famous are always too busy. And so people get left by the side. That's sad. His third wife was Molly Punderson. You've probably seen her on the bicycle out there at Stockbridge. They used to go bicycle riding later in life, riding through Stockbridge. Molly, he met her at a poetry class. Can you imagine? Nora Rockwell went to a poetry class. He was 65 years old. He's picking up poetry. She was 64. She had taught at Milton Academy for many, many years. They got along very nicely, but she made sure he got his nose to the grindstone. She ran the show. Gotta get to work, gotta get to work. No, you have to get out to the studio and I'm coming out to check on you. So Molly made sure he kept on working. Rockwell families lived in New Rochelle, New York, Arlington, Vermont, and Stockbridge, Massachusetts. He suffered from depression off and on during his life. That's because he used to question his work. I shouldn't be doing this material all the time. I shouldn't be doing kids and Santa Claus and ordinary people. He even went over to Europe and studied over there. And when he came back, he was lost again until someone said, get back to what you were doing. Ordinary people, children, old men with wrinkles. Get back to that. And he got back to that, and that's what made him famous. So he got some good advice. He had many appointments over the years with a psychoanalyst, Eric Erickson, because he would be up, he'd be down, he'd be up, he'd be down, so he needed help constantly. A perfectionist, he was almost never satisfied with any of his illustrations, even though everyone was praising them. He was never satisfied. If he had a brush, he'd want to go back in and start working on them again. Probably another meeting. That's like having another classroom. A door open next to you. Whoa, not so good. Or an open classroom. Remember when they used to slide the doors back and forth? Oh, please. I didn't like that. So, he really was a complex man, like most people who are very, very famous. Now I'm going to get into this. If you think I'm going to be boring, you're wrong, because I have these. And there's a story behind almost every one of his pieces of art. It is a story. Okay. Everyone here, sitting here today, you know his art. You have your favorites. Some people can't choose a favorite because there are too many to choose from. I mean, he did over 4,000 pieces of artwork. That doesn't even count the sketches, the pen and ink sketches. Over 4,000. And all of us think, he, you know, Saturday Evening Post, Saturday Evening Post. Oh, no, a lot more than the Saturday Evening Post, as you will see. He was all over the place. He even said he was never going to do ads because I'm selling myself. I'm not going to do ads. Did he wind up doing ads? Oh, yes, he did. You have to have some food on the table. So from time to time, that's what he did. I brought the Four Freedoms with me, and I have a story about them. Well, right up here, these are very, very famous. This is during World War II. Freedom of speech, freedom of worship, freedom from want, and freedom from fear. Great story behind these. I also brought these three. In 1955, he was so famous that they took a poll on the Saturday Evening Post readers. What are the three most favorite of his paintings by that time? This came in first. the grandmother sitting with the grandchild in the diner, having breakfast, and they're saying grace. Afterwards, you certainly may come up and take a good close look at these. That was first. This came in second. Soldier coming home after World War II. And there's a lot in this. You have to be up close to see it. And almost everyone in it is a redhead. He loved doing redheads with freckles. He loved that. And it's a great, and this one, priceless. The little girl with her doll and the doctor checking out the doll. This wasn't the only one he did of a doctor and a doll. He did others too. But this one came in third in 1955. Norman Rockwell was born on February 3rd, 1894. Now just to clue you in here, 1894, Robert Frost graduated from Lawrence High School in 1892.
Oh, wow.
And John Greenleaf Whittier died in 1892. Very, very close. I'm quite sure that Robert Frost read Snowbound in high school. So this is the time frame. According to Norman, he was born feet first at 2 a.m. and was given the name Norman Percival by his mother. Whoa. He hated that middle name, Percival. They were all E's. E in that word. All O. As soon as he left home, he dropped Percival. He even dropped the letter P, like he had no middle name. That was gone. See, I take copious notes. As a young boy, he had a difficult time. Both parents were remote in their relationships with Norman and his older brother, Jarvis. However, Norman started drawing at a young age, and that became his life. He certainly was not very athletic, no. But art occupied most of his time, and he loved drawing. I have a son who loves drawing since grade three, no, excuse me, since age three. And he just had a show at Northern Essex Community College. So he is coming along. He lives down at the Whittier birthplace. So that's a great place to be when you're painting. 69 acres of land there. At age 10, he discovered, now this is a quote, "My monstrous Adam's apple, my narrow shoulders, my long neck, and my pigeon toes." He wasn't too thrilled with his physique. But he overcame all of that with his wonderful artistic ability. "Maybe as I grew up and found that the world wasn't the perfectly pleasant place I had thought it to be, I unconsciously decided that even if it wasn't an ideal world, it should be. And so I painted only the ideal aspects of it. There were grandpas who played baseball with kids." There's grandpa. He has his spats on, he has his vest on, and he's playing baseball. He loved old men and he loved kids. He was a great storyteller, probably the greatest storyteller that ever lived, because he told the whole story in one painting, one illustration. Not five or six pages, one. And if it didn't tell the story, he discarded it. He discarded lots of his artwork, just didn't come up to what he thought it should be. I got these all numbered. They were grandpas, and boys fished from logs and got up circuses in their backyard. If there was sadness in this created world of his, it was a pleasant sadness. And this is his pleasant sadness. The son leaving the farm to go to college. And his poor father sitting on the running board, wondering what's going to happen. My son is leaving. It's called Breaking Ties. Now, I just found out this past month in a Saturday Evening Post magazine that I continue to get. But there's a wonderful story behind this. A man bought the original from Norman Rockwell for $900. This is in 1962. The man took it home. He had a wife he wasn't getting along too well with, and so he probably didn't trust her that much. So he also bought a print of this. And in the house, he hung the print up, and he hid the original behind a wall paneling with four others.
Wow.
And they never found this until just recently. There was a divorce. He handed over the prints. He kept the originals behind the wall panel. And then when the man who bought it, his son, didn't know the story, and he took the print to the Norman Rockwell Museum to hang there, and they looked it over and said, whoa, 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 this is not the original, this is only a print. The son was, what is happening here? It's been hanging on a wall for 30 years. And then he went home looking around, he and his brother, and they found it. And it just recently was auctioned off for $14 million.
Oh, my goodness.
$14 million. The original. Oh, art will never bring you bread. How wrong that is. $14 million. Wow. Now, if that is something, I'm going to show you this one right away, too, because this is going to be auctioned off shortly. It's called The Rookie.
Oh, yeah.
The Rookie. It's going to be auctioned off at Sotheby's pretty soon, and the estimates go into the $100 million. That's what they think it's going to go for, $100 million or over, because this is the Red Sox locker room. The Red Sox locker room, and up here it says Frank Sullivan, the pitcher, Ted Williams, right there, Jackie Jensen, used to play for the Red Sox, and one of my favorite Red Sox, Billy Goodman, who played everywhere in the Red Sox. He played every position. And here's the rookie showing up in the Boston Red Sox locker room. And they say the minimum is going to be $100 million. Wow. Woo. All right. The summers I spent in the country with his grandparents as a child became part of this idealized view of life. Those summers seemed blissful, sort of a happy dream. And those summers had a lot to do with what he painted all his life, that special idealistic view of the United States, of America. The part that we all loved to think of when we were kids. And everything was, seemed to be happy, and oh, having a blast. No little league yet, and choosing up sides with the bat handle, and no uniforms, and no umpires. Those were good days, and you could leave your house unlocked. You could leave your bike outside, no one was going to take it. Gone forever. He always had what he called, quote, a bad case of American nostalgia. Nostalgia. We all have that too. Only we can't get up there and do it. He did. In the middle of his sophomore year in high school, he dropped out of school at age 16. And he went to art school in New York City full time at the National Academy of Design and at the Art Student League under George Bridgman and Thomas Fogarty, two wonderful art teachers back then. Later in life, Rockwell said, I put everything into my work. A lot of artists do that. Their work is the only thing they've got that gives them an identity. I feel that I don't have anything else, that I must keep working or I'll go back to being pigeon-toed, narrow-shouldered, just a big old lump. When I was younger, I used to work night and day, possessed by a sort of panic that I'd lose everything if I didn't drive myself. I've given up the night work lately, but the drive is still in me. This is when he's an older man. People ask me why I don't take vacations or retire altogether. I can't stop work. That's the long and the short of it. None of us want to really stop working. Not really. Life would be tough. His first cover for the Saturday Evening Post was published on May 20th, 1916. A boy pushing a baby carriage. This is his first cover. Pushing a baby carriage, and the other kids are heckling him. He's dressed like he's going to Sunday meeting, and he's pushing a baby. And the other kids are going to play baseball. Now, Norman Rockwell had a little trick to this. He used the same boy for all three of the boys. He used only one model for the three boys. I guess he didn't have any extra money, so you're only going to pay him once. Same model. It's a great, he even has the baby bottle in his pocket, the nipple sticking out there. He doesn't show the baby, but he shows the bonnet. The bonnet. That's the first one, and it says 5 cents. Rockwell's first Saturday Evening Post cover. The copy, 5 cents. Not bad. Not bad. In 1914, most illustrations were reproduced in black and white. We painted with Illustrator's black, which is really a brown, so that the paintings wouldn't look funereal. His models were friends, neighbors, and relatives, especially from Arlington, Vermont, then from Stockbridge, Massachusetts. Wherever he went, they became the models. His favorite subjects were kids. Santa Claus, love Santa Claus, many of those, and picturesque old men. He said, painting pretty girls has never been my strong point. I don't know why. I think he did a great job painting pretty girls and women when you look at the paintings he did of them. And some of them were his daughter-in-law. One of them was his second wife, Mary Bostow. The one in the museum, and she's looking out of the painting, and she has a rather low-cut top, and someone's checking things out. It was his son checking things out. Didn't have to pay his son. According to Rockwell's autobiography, he went into illustration. This is very important to him. Went into illustration because, quote, it was a profession with a great tradition, a profession I could be proud of. I guess my temperament and abilities were the other part. Being somebody to my parents and my older brother Jarvis and to my friends meant a lot to me. He loved being an illustrator. He always said he was not a painter. Not a painter, an illustrator, even though he was painting. Confusing, very confusing. During his lifetime, he worked on magazine stories, book illustrations, greeting cards, advertisements. He worked for McCall's, Life, Collier's, The Literary Digest, The American, Country Gentleman, Look, Popular Science, Good Housekeeping, Hallmark Cards, Coca-Cola, Crest, Budweiser, Amway, Jell-O, Plymouth's, Parker Pens, Pan Am Airline, Ford, Fleischmann's yeast, even Skippy peanut butter. He said he wasn't going to do any ads, but he did an awful lot of ads. Spent a lot of money doing ads. He spent 10 months painting the Four Freedoms. Those four. Yeah. 10 months. As a result of President Franklin Roosevelt's annual message to Congress on January 6, 1941. 1941. Then he brought them to Washington, D.C. But the federal government wasn't interested in them. Wasn't interested. So he took them home. Then the Saturday Evening Post published them. Not as covers, but inside the magazine. They became very, very popular. In 16 major cities, 1,220,000 people got them if they purchased a war bond. They got those for free for purchasing a war bond. That's what the government decided to use them for when they figured they could use Mr. Rockwell. The total amount for war bonds sold was $133 million in 16 cities in the 40s. That was a lot of money for the war effort. He did his part. By the way, he was in the Navy in World War I, but he didn't last too long in the Navy. But some of the officers asked if he would do their portraits for them. He did a few of their portraits, and then they gave him an early release. He was too valuable at home, so he got out of there. No other paintings in history have been so widely printed and distributed, thanks to Norman Rockwell's efforts. Those four right there. No other series of paintings in history. They went everywhere. And they're still as good today as they were back in the 40s. Still have the same meaning. This one. Oh, see, I am surprised no one said, where is this one? Before the shot. Before the shot. Shows a picture of a boy checking out the doctor's credentials. Little did they mean to him. Mr. Rockwell wrote out the check for this boy as the boy was tucking his shirt into his pants at the end of the session. He got paid right on the spot. Right on the spot. He paid all of his models, by the way. All of his models. Even if they were friends, relatives, he paid them all. There's another one like this. And there's a new cover on a Saturday Evening Post of an elderly gentleman in the doctor's office, and he's about to get a shot, and it's a woman doctor. It's a woman doctor, and he's checking out her credentials. So they did a little bit on this. Saturday Evening Post just keeps on bringing back Rockwell, one way or the other. Okay. The painting of the three empires. The three empires. Oh, do you remember this? Oh, that testing. It's raining out. And you remember going to Fenway Park probably. You're in the middle of the game and it starts raining and then the umpires are going to come out and say yes or no. And you're, oh, I don't want to go home. I want to see them into the game. Now, these three umpires were famous. Larry Goetz, Beans Reardon, and Lou Jorda. Baseball people from back then, they were very well-known umpires. And the Brooklyn manager is Clyde Supforth, and the Pittsburgh manager is Billy Mayer. Oh. They all got involved in this.
Did he ever take a photograph?
Oh, yes, I'm getting to that.
Oh,
yes, because things change. Well, that's part of the story. He get jumped on for that. But that's what everyone does now. Rockwell did illustrations for Tom Sawyer and Huckleberry Finn. He went to Hannibal, Missouri to get the feel of the town and the people. it was almost as if the two boys were still there. Everyone in Hannibal was telling him stories about Tom Sawyer and Huckleberry Finn and Mark Twain. And he came back with many sketches, and he came back with all kinds of costumes that the people gave him because he loved collecting costumes for his models. His most unpopular cover was this one. Most unpopular. Oh, and you can see why.
Yeah.
It's before Christmas. Yeah. The little boy is going through his father's bureau drawer, and he finds Santa Claus's outfit. Whoa, look at the expression on his face. The kids keep telling me there's no Santa Claus. Maybe there isn't. Maybe my father is Santa Claus. The women sent all kinds of letters because they were disillusioning the children. That's why they were upset with this. I think it's hilarious.
Yeah.
But, and then he had this other, oh boy, this caused quite a stir, a big stir. His somewhat risque cover of The Mermaid in the Lobster Trap being carried on the back of the fisherman brought a few angry letters to the post and many delighted letters. The men sent the delighted letters. Now, but there's nothing showing. There's nothing showing. I think it's a pretty good taste. But for the Saturday Evening Post of those days, now, there's another picture of the real model. I didn't bring that with me today because there's something showing. So I didn't want to have anyone, you know, collapse on me. I don't want anyone to go over backwards. I heard a lot of laughter. See, I did bring it with me, but it's in another book. Oh, my God. So that one, one of his strongest paintings was for Look magazine, in 1964. It was called The Problem We Lived With.
Oh, yes.
The Problem We Lived With. This was a wonderful illustration. He did so much through one painting. And notice what he left out on purpose. The faces of the marshals. No faces. He wanted everyone to look at the little girl. And the little girl herself didn't pose for this, but he had two sisters pose for it. And then he told them that he used a composite of the two. No one is really sure if it's one or the other or both. But that was a famous, famous Look magazine. Abraham Lincoln was Rockwell's favorite American, Abraham Lincoln. He painted Lincoln, the rail splitter, as an advertisement in 1964 for Lincoln Savings Bank. Savings Bank. And he did Lincoln for the defense for a Saturday Evening Post story illustration in 1962. He also did a portrait of Raymond Massey as Lincoln. Remember the actor, Raymond Massey? He did one of Raymond Massey as Lincoln. He tried teaching art, but he was not a successful teacher. He just didn't enjoy it. Probably the students didn't enjoy it either because he was a perfectionist. And probably, that has to be just so for him. Rockwell did only one painting of war. Only one. All of that time. It was a World War II machine gunner, an American machine gunner. And he said, I don't like to do pictures which glorify killing, even in a good cause. It's the only one he did. He used his son Peter in a painting of a soda jerk. Peter complained, I'm not that goofy looking. The soda jerk, an That's his son, Peter.
He's cute.
He did this a number of times, and no two models were there at the same time. One model would show up and he'd do that. And then another one coming. They were never there all at the same time. They never saw it until it came out in the Saturday Evening Post with all of them in it. And it's a good one. See, I used to be a soda jerk. So I liked it. Remember the Hampton Beach Casino with the big long soda fountain?
Yeah.
I was a soda jerk there for John Deneen, who ran Hampton Beach. He ran Hampton Beach. He ran the police department, too. Okay. His painting, Family Tree, was tough to do. It took him over 3 months to do it. He kept changing the people in it. His family tree, this is what he made up anyway. It starts with a pirate. A pirate. And it works its way up. And then he stuck himself in there too. He loved doing that. He has his own, himself in many of his paintings. And there he is, he's the minister. Oh, what a sour looking face he has. The minister. Took him so much time to do it. Finally he got this good looking family though. Up at the top, nice looking family. But there's the pirate, oh my lord.
Yeah.
That was the first Rockwell. That's kind of scary. Yeah, all right. Oh, there's so many papers. Okay. He used Ann Morgan, the daughter of friends, for the Crest toothpaste ad. Look, Mom, no cavities. Look, Mom, no cavities. Look, Mom, no cavities. He said he couldn't paint girls and women, but he could. He did a good job with them. Now, there's a story behind this, though. The model showed up. She had two front teeth. There are no two front teeth in this painting. There are no two front teeth. So all he did was paint her and paint out the teeth. Gone. But then he got himself into trouble because a post cover, he couldn't use Ann Morgan again because that would be unfair to Crest. He had to use another model who had all of her teeth. So this time he painted out the model's two front teeth for two different paintings. Very strange, but she's happy to show her mouth. Two front teeth gone. We remember that too. Then you could whistle. Look at that. This is the only two-part cover he ever did. Coming and going. And if you look closely at this, you can come up afterwards. I'll put them all over the place for you. If you look closely at this, there's only one person in both paintings that has the same expression on her face. No? Oh, who was this? She wasn't too thrilled going, and she wasn't too thrilled coming home.
The grandmother.
I like to call her the mother-in-law. The mother-in-law. There she is in the back. Going. Everyone else is thrilled. Oh, they're going to have a great time. Coming home, they're all pooped. And there she is in the back. Still has the same expression on her face. He drew scenes 2 days after his studio fire in Vermont, in Arlington. You know about the studio fire? Oh boy. He used to love to smoke a pipe. And his wife would always say, when you finish for the day, get rid of the pipe. Take everything out of it. And one night, he didn't, and he left it there, and it tipped over. and his whole studio was gone. Gone. He lost all his costumes. He lost originals and copies, all kinds of prints. He lost it all.
When did that happen?
It happened in 1943, when he was in Vermont, not when he was at Stockbridge, because he went from Vermont down to Stockbridge afterwards. He lost everything, and people heard, you know, oh my God, Norman Rockwell lost everything. So they started sending him more pipes and more costumes. They kept coming and coming and coming. Everyone in, probably in the United States sent him a pipe. His wife didn't appreciate that. And then 2 days after it, he did this sketch about the whole thing, the firemen arriving. And it's really funny. It's funny. Most people were going, oh my God. And he's doing a nice sketch about it. He even had the firemen stay afterwards, and they had a little barbecue. Barbecue afterwards. They didn't save a thing. It was gone to the ground, but they had a barbecue, and he had a great time. He drew illustrations for Louisa May Alcott's Little Women, and also painted Louisa May Alcott being interviewed by her first publisher. She's being interviewed, and he did the painting of Louisa May Alcott. He did 56 years of Boy Scout calendars. 56 years. The last one in 1975. He loved working with the Scouts. Great calendars. Fantastic calendars. This one is very patriotic. Very patriotic. That's the way it was back then. He did the four season calendars. I have them right here. He did, this is just 1 year. He did this every year for the four seasons. Spring, summer, autumn, and winter. Every year he came out with those. And they're really wonderful. Spring, there are the kids running around outside the schoolhouse. Springtime, they're getting out of school. There's summer, and he's watching the old train going by out there, apparently. And here are the kids looking at the diving board because they're on their way back to school. And the dog, naturally, he had dogs in lots of his paintings. And then they're having a blast, coasting. In Haverhill, they call it sledding. Sledding, not from Lawrence. You gotta call it sledding. It was coasting. He used a sled to go coasting.
You're using a sled.
I know you're using a sled, but we coasted down the hill. Sometimes not on the sled. Sometimes right here, and we fell off the sled. He did a watercolor of Henry Ford driving through Detroit in his first automobile. Henry Ford. For the 50th anniversary cover for the Ford Motor Company. He went back in time and he did the painting of Mr. Ford and the old putt-putt going down the street and everyone running for their lives. He did a day in the life of a little boy, and then he did a day in the life of a little girl, and they're right here. I hope you take a look at these after. You can't see them up there, but take a look at them. Life of a little girl, the life of a little boy. The end of the day for the little girl, she's kneeling down saying her night prayers. For the boy, no night prayers. He's into bed without saying his prayers. Typical boy. That's the way it was. All right. Norman Rockwell painted the portraits of many famous people. The only trouble is, we didn't see most of these. He painted them for them, and then they got them. And that was it. And that's a shame. He had Gary Cooper. There's Gary right there. Gary Cooper on a cover of a Saturday Evening Post magazine. And this is in May 24th, 1930. Gary Cooper. And he's getting makeup on. Not too good for a cowboy. Especially Gary Cooper. putting on lipstick. Not too good. I don't think the boys would like that. Gary Cooper, Bing Crosby, Slim Pickens, Red Buttons, Anne Margaret, Robert Cummings, Van Heflin, Mike Connors, Bob Hope, Jack Benny, Gracie Allen, Stephanie Powers, Keenan Wynn, Ethel Barrymore, Loretta Young, Linda Darnell, Richard Widmark, Eddie Arcaro, a famous jockey, Colonel Sanders, Kentucky Fried Chicken, Arnold Palmer, many of the Kennedys, including JFK, and I'll show you that one, right? He did Jackie Kennedy too, and he did many of the astronauts. He did Lady Bird Johnson, Mrs. Goldwater, Prime Minister Nehru. Prime Minister Nehru showed up, and Mr. Whittier didn't like the outfit. What did I just say? I get carried away because I work at Whittier's. Mr. Rockwell didn't like the outfit, so he had Prime Minister Nehru change. The color wasn't right. He wanted dark instead of white. So he made a change into a dark outfit, and then he sat for him. He did Clifton Webb. Remember him? Mm-hmm. Clifton Webb. Van Johnson. Oh, yeah. Boris Karloff. Mm-hmm. Lassie. Lassie. And many more of the rich and famous. Now, I have to let you know this. He never went to them. They came to him. Mm-hmm. So if they wanted their portrait done, they came to either Arlington, Vermont, when he lived there, or to Stockbridge. They came to him. Not bad. When Frank Sinatra found out that Rockwell was going to do his portrait, Sinatra was so happy that he said, I love this quote, I felt like I was dipped in gin. Frank Sinatra fits him to a T. I felt like I was dipped in gin. And Frank Sinatra went to Stockbridge, showed up at night, didn't want to cause a stir, was in there. Mr. Rockwell took pictures because Sinatra was in the hurry. Get back out into the limo and off he went, gone. No one in Stockbridge even saw Frank Sinatra there. Rockwell also did a portrait of Walter Brennan for the Cowboy Hall of Fame. Rockwell said, Walter was a scream. We had so much fun, I couldn't get any work done. I can picture Walter Brennan acting up. When John Wayne showed up in Stockbridge to sit for Rockwell, that caused quite a stir. Norman said, Wayne won't ever take his hat off because he's bald. He's bald. He's much more imposing with his hat on. And he went from the Red Lion Inn, John Wayne, down the steps with his six-shooters on and walked around down there and made a big show of himself, John Wayne. Mr. Rockwell was a good friend and neighbor of Grandma Moses. Grandma Moses. He helped her cut her birthday cake for her 89th birthday party in 1949. He also did her portrait and included her in his Christmas homecoming painting. And it's right here. And there's Grandma Moses right there. Right there. And this is his family, Christmas homecoming. He just stuck her right in there with the rest of the family, all the Whittiers. He even put himself in there with the pipe. Right there. So come up after if you want to see that up closely. All right. During his long career, Rockwell changed from sketching on site to taking pictures. That's when he was jumped on by other artists. You're supposed to do it on site. Well, he had a difficult time doing that because he did a lot of kids, and kids don't sit still. You know, it didn't work. It was very difficult. He would have the pictures taken. He had a photographer take the pictures. When he said, now, then they'd take the picture, and he'd take it back, and then he'd do his painting. He sketched from the pictures. He had a great memory. He remembered, even in early Saturday evening post covers, all the troubles he had with each one of his paintings. He remembered the models' names, when each of them was painted. He remembered the technique he used. He even knew where the props had come from. Great memory. Pop Fredericks, an old actor, was a great model for Rockwell. You've seen him many, many times. Pop Fredericks. He was the doctor in Before the Shot. He was the doctor. Then he was a thug. Then he was a cellist. He was Benjamin Franklin. He was Mr. Pickwick. He was Santa Claus. He was an actor. He was a hobo. He was a tourist. He was a pompous politician, a piccoloist, and a Christmas reveler. One model. He loved painting, this fellow. He had the face, he had the expression. Norman had to bribe his son Tommy, who posed reading his sister's diary. Oh, there he is. It's his son reading his sister's diary. Of course, there wasn't any sister, you know. There was no girl in the family, but he's his sister. He had to bribe him to sit for this. He actually paid him. Then he had lots of trouble painting the baseball pitcher because he wasn't an athlete. And so he had a difficult time. This was a special. This was for the 100th year of baseball. And look at that. Is that an awesome picture? Back in those old days, the umpire used to be behind the pitcher. There's the umpire back there. And there's this pitcher winding up to whip that ball in. He had a difficult time. He couldn't get the right movements, you know? Where should the arm be? Where should the leg be? But he finally conquered it, but it's a strange one. I love the picture with one eye showing. One eye showing. Great face. Great uniform, by the way, too. Great uniform. And then he did, this was his first painting he ever did in Arlington, Vermont. And I love it. The girl playing marbles. Marbles. And the girl is whipping the boys. She has all the marbles and they have none. They lost every one of their marbles. He did a good job on this one. And notice her face. She has freckles. She has freckles and she has red hair.
Yeah, she has determination.
Oh, she has determination. She's gonna get that last marble. By hook or by crook. He loved doing kids. I wish he was still around. Yeah. I wish he was still around. And this was his most famous child model. She was in many. The girl at the mirror.
Oh, yeah.
The girl at the mirror. She's just becoming a young woman. And she's looking in the mirror, and she's looking at a famous movie star. I'm surprised there weren't any boys in this looking at the famous movie star, because the movie star was Jane Russell. Jane Russell is on the cover of the magazine, right there. Jane Russell. And this was his most famous. Her name was Mary Whalen. Mary Whalen. He loved her as a model because he would do the pose and she would have it right away. The expression on her face, right away. And she was so easy to work with. Many of his paintings have this girl as she got a little older. He didn't like her when she got no longer a child. He didn't like that, but she's in many of them.
But she still has her doll.
And she's, pardon?
I love that, she still has her doll.
She still has her doll, yes, the doll. On the left-hand side,
really,
yeah.
She still
has
her doll.
This is nice. And she does become quite a beauty when she gets older, too. I've seen pictures of her when she got older, so. Jane Russell. Okay. And here it is. I told you I had it. I told you, ready? There it is. The Runaway. The Runaway. There's a great story behind The Runaway. A great story. Massachusetts State Police officer. This man just died just recently. Just recently, probably 3 years ago. And this is one of his sons, one of Rockwell's sons. And he scheduled it in Pittsfield, Massachusetts, in a Howard Johnson's. A Howard Johnson's. And then after the whole thing was done, the pictures taken, then he got back to his studio and he said, that doesn't work right. You know, they had all the 28 flavors listed up there in the back. And so he changed the whole thing to a diner. A diner. The other one, I've seen the picture of it, the Hojo soda jerk with the hat on, you know, on the 28th. But he changed it because he wanted
attention to
this. This comes from his own lifetime. He used to run away from home. Norman Rockwell used to run away. But he never got very far. And so he, because, you know, supper time, he turned around and go home. Not going to continue. And so he wanted to make it look like it's local, like a diner instead of a Howard Johnson's out somewhere on a highway. So he changed the whole thing. And while I'm at it, many of his models showed up and he did the whole thing. They were never, ever published. He'd find someone else, and the next person turned out to be a better model, it looked better in the painting. And so lots of people in his lifetime were very disappointed that they never got in the painting. And they didn't know until the painting came out, until the magazine was published. Well, that was kind of tough to take. You know, you would be bragging. I sat for Norman Rockwell. I was going to be on the Saturday Evening Post cover. And then someone else was. That wasn't too good. And this one, we remember these days. We all do. After the prom. Only I don't think none of us went to a diner after the prom. Maybe someone did, but most of us didn't. I remember going to Blindstrip's in Boston, or the Meadows, Vaughn Monroe's place out on Route 9, the Meadows. You drove halfway across the United States to have a meal after the prom. No wonder we got home early in the morning. And I like this. This one he calls his chinless painting. Chinless. No one has a full chin. They're all rounded off. They're all rounded off. And it's a nice one. Okay. And then we have, I don't have this with me. My wife wouldn't let me take it off the wall. She didn't trust me. She knows I fell down twice this winter. She doesn't want me to fall down with the painting that we got out there at Rockwell Museum. Main Street in Stockbridge. Main Street in Stockbridge with his little studio on top of the market. Oh, my wife and I went out there 3 years ago. I had never been there before, and here I was going to places doing Norman Rockwell, and I was never at his studio. We finally went on a AAA trip, and we had the first two seats on this beautiful bus. So I thought I was driving the bus. It was really nice. And we had a special time. We stayed at Williams College. And then we went to... Pardon?
Tanglewood.
We went to Tanglewood for John Williams's 80th birthday party. Oh, 23,000 people were there. But we were underneath. We had a roof over our head, and we froze to death.
It was so cold.
Very, very cold. It was terrible.
And windy.
Oh, and it was windy. It was terrible. But Yo-Yo Ma was there. Mm-hmm. And Steven Spielberg was there. Wow. I mean, it was a big time. I'm going back. Next time I'm going to take my time. But we went to the studio and it was awesome. Mm-hmm. And it keeps on changing. They keep on changing things. Oh, if you've never been there, you're missing a great place. And I'm going back. All right. In the painting, Main Street, Stockbridge, he began it. This was from McCall's magazine. He began it in the mid-50s, the 1950s, and he finished it in 1967. He wasn't too good for deadlines. 1967. And then when they finally finished it, he realized he had to change it. He had to bring it up to date. So what he did was put in two cars, one coming in from the right and another one leaving. They were 1960s models that brought it up to date, putting the two cars in there. Get away with it, too. And then he did the golden rule. And he did took a long time to do this. A very, very long time. The golden rule. What we should be doing in this world today. He had the right idea, and we're not doing any of this. And it's sad what the world is coming to. I wish he was still around to do things like this. Very good. This is the only painting he ever did with no one in it. No one in it. And the only one. And it is beautiful. It is beautiful. Lots of people buy prints of this hanging up in their homes because it's really, really nice. Now, he said there's no person in it, but there is. But there is a person in it. This is Molly's bonnet. These are Molly's sneakers. And these are Molly's garden gloves. The spirit of Molly is in it. That's how he explained it. And it is beautiful. And there's one robin. See the robin on the doorstep? One robin peeking in. You always like to add these little extra little pieces in there. That look at. Didn't want any empty space. Fit something in that fits with this. And it is really nice.
What's the name of it?
This is called Spring Flowers.
Spring Flowers.
Spring Flowers. McCall's magazine, May 1969. I really like this one. Okay, I'm down here, the golden rule. I'm getting there, folks. Don't hurry. Okay, I just don't want to have anyone, you know, getting hungry. In the early 60s, the Saturday Evening Post advertising declined. Lots of magazines came out. Both Life magazine and Look magazine had higher circulations. And television was also taking a bigger share of advertising. The Post staff changed. The cover was changed to pictures, not illustrations. Norman Rockwell said he left for health reasons. Actually, he sent the following to the Post. Quote, I have come to the conviction that the work I want to do no longer fits into the Post scheme of things. And he left. That was in 1963. His last Post cover was published on May 29th, 1963. It was of Egypt's President Nasser. Remember Nasser? He had done 323 Post covers, starting in 1916. When he left the Post after 47 years, he didn't get a cent. And the Post didn't even inform its readers that Rockwell had departed. He just started appearing in other magazines, Life, Look, that was it. They never even told their subscribers that he was gone. Even though Norman was sad, he said, "I showed the America I knew and observed to others who might not have noticed." To others who might not have noticed. Now, you don't take a glance at any one of his paintings. You have to really concentrate to get the whole thing. So he had the right idea. He did that. Now I have. He did the gossips. The gossips. You all remember this one. Oh, yes. The gossips. Oh, this took him a while to do. He loved doing it, and he stuck himself in there. Because they're gossiping about him. See? It's about him. There's the lady talking about him. But down here, he finds out from this man. That's about me. Me, he's right there. And then he turns around and he gets the woman who started the gossip. You started this whole story. You did it. There she is up there. See her up there? There she is down there.
Same expression.
Oh, yes. Look at that expression. Oh, my God. You. I can. Okay. And then we have this famous one, too. All right.
You said he stopped in May of 63. Did he do anything for anyone in that November? 22nd?
I don't know.
For JFK? No.
Oh, for JFK, he did.
Yeah, it was 6 months later.
Oh, he yes, stopped. He did. Yes, he did. Everyone remembers this one? Yeah. A triple header.
Yeah.
A triple header. I like this one. All right. Now, he said, "I received many letters noting mistakes in my covers. I always apologize, but sometimes it was not a mistake at all. In 1947, after 27 years of this, I painted an April Fool cover, which I definitely loaded with 45 mistakes. 45 mistakes. But you can't win. A man wrote claiming to have found 120 mistakes. So then you get even. I did 3 April Fool covers and had fun doing them. 3 of them he did. And boy, you could stay there forever. I mean, you could miss 3 meals just trying to find all the mistakes in this thing, over and over. In 1973, a movie was made of Rockwell and Stockbridge. It won an Academy Award as Best Documentary of the Year. That was 1973. Another movie was made the following year of Norman Rockwell and Robert Frost. His famous fellow New Englander. That movie not only won the New York Film Festival Gold Medal, it also won the International Film Award as Best Documentary of the Year. Can you imagine Norman Rockwell and Robert Frost in a documentary? That's awesome. Awesome. See, I'm from Lawrence, folks. I was born and brought up in Lawrence, Robert Frost territory. Robert Frost territory. And here I am working at Whittier's birthplace. I gotta be careful. And I'm doing Norman Rockwell. This is kind of strange. His wife, Molly, once said, because they traveled often, "He always has to buy brushes and paints when he goes on a trip. He never seems to want to bring his own with him. Wants to get a new set everywhere he goes. What a waste of time," she said, "and money." She ran the show. She really did. When asked to name a personal favorite among the presidents of the United States that he had painted, he hesitated to name one. "They were all very nice to me, but of all the people I ever painted," anyone want to take a guess?
Rockwell.
JFK.
JFK?
Lincoln.
Lincoln.
No other guests? Of all the people I ever painted, all the people I ever painted, not just presidents. Dwight Eisenhower was just about the kindest, gentlest man I ever came across. Dwight David Eisenhower. Always at his best every time he talked to me. Every time. This is the only time he didn't have it done at Stockbridge. He went to the White House. Went to the White House. That was a different situation. Now I'm going to show you that painting, and you have to agree with this. I have lots of albums. I can't carry them all. They're too heavy, but I brought this. This is beautiful.
Oh,
is that a beautiful painting? Look at the expression. He said Eisenhower had wonderful facial expression and always very happy. Happy. Even when Rockwell was making a mistake. And I think Norman Rockwell planned this, but something happened to the first one. So he went back to Washington to do it again. He had a little trick up his sleeve. But isn't that neat?
Yes.
And while I'm at it.
Does the family still have that picture, or would it be in a museum? Or?
I think Mr. Eisenhower has it. No, he had it. I don't know where it is now. I'm sorry. But he did also the candidates. Adlai Stevenson. That came out very nicely, too. That came out very nice. And then he did, oh boy, Richard Nixon. And he said he had to touch this up a number of times. The nose. That's what he said. He had to fix the nose because Nixon's nose was too big for his face. So he just changed it a little bit. And I imagine Mr. Nixon didn't appreciate that at all. But this one is great.
His hair looks so blonde.
John Fitzgerald Kennedy. Isn't that beautiful?
Was that done for a cover, or was that done for a cover of a magazine, or did they just use that, didn't they, on the?
They used this on the cover.
Okay, I have that magazine.
You have that magazine. Yeah. Then he did others. He did others of John Fitzgerald Kennedy.
I'll do that one.
Did he give the picture to Kennedy?
I'm pretty sure he did, yes.
Okay.
They are not in the Rockwell collection.
Oh, okay.
He did. But he did so many. Whoops, I want to show you this one too.
That's the one I like.
The teacher.
Yeah.
Isn't that neat?
Yes. Yeah.
The teacher. And see what they have up on the blackboard?
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday, Mr.
Jonesy. They called her Jonesy. The kids called her Jonesy.
Down at the bottom.
Yeah. One of them was a little divil. Jonesy. That's a very nice painting. But you know, there are over 4,000 of these. You know, we can only see so many at a time. Oh, see, this
there
one's in there again.
Yeah.
It's in there again. This whole book I got for $5. $5 down in Rockport because it had a little water damage. I grabbed it before someone got ahead of me because it's loaded with his paintings and his life, even his sketches. Whoops. Okay. See, even his sketches. It's loaded with his sketches, black and white sketches. Loaded with them, of famous people and people who are not famous. And, oh, there it is right up there. Freedom of Worship. Freedom of Worship, it's up on the blackboard. This book is priceless.
Yes,
Oh, the traveling salesman. Good luck to him. That's quite a right. I've heard some nice phones down at Whittier's birthplace. You know, because they have no sign there. And so sometimes I start doing a dance up there. It livens me up, you know. Because it's an old house and I cobwebs. No, I clean the place.
How did he pay his models? By the job or by the hour?
He paid them by the hour.
Really? How much? Do you know?
Well, at the beginning, the kids got $5 an hour.
I know.
But that was good money back in the teens and the 20s. That was a lot of money.
Yeah.
As he got older, a lot more money, because he was going to get a lot more money for his work.
Mm-hmm.
And there's Eddie Arcaro.
Oh, yeah.
Oh. Eddie Arcaro.
I always liked him.
Oh. He was quite a jockey. When I was in high school, I remember some of my friends saying to me, "You ought to be a jockey." You know, I didn't weigh much. "You ought to be a jockey, and we'll train the horse with you, and you can ride up at Rockingham." I probably would have had a good life. You know that? Jockey. One woman on the jury. One woman on the jury, and she's not going to give in. She is not going to give in. Oh, look at that. Look at the expressions on those faces. Is this good? And, wait a minute, is this it? Oh, he stuck himself in there, too. There he is. See him right there looking over the shoulder? He put himself in there. He loved that.
Was Molly the woman?
Look at that. One woman, and she is not giving in. It's a woman's world after all, especially on the jury. Oh, this is his daughter-in-law going to church.
Oh,
daughter-in-law going to church with the kids. And there's the daddy sitting in the chair hiding, reading the Sunday paper. His daughter-in-law was a very beautiful woman. He used her in quite a few. There she is again, right there. That's his daughter-in-law. I could keep you here till breakfast tomorrow morning. But, and the sailor, you know, trying to, you know, have a date with this girl. He took so many pictures. You can see the pictures there, too?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The pictures, and then you see the painting. And look at the men looking out the window. All the old men looking out the window saying, "Oh, I wish I were young again." Whoa. I wish I were young again. This thing, like, and there he is in his studio.
Oh, yeah. That's nice.
In his studio. His studio was as neat as a pin. Before he ever went home every day, back to the house, he cleaned it. And he cleaned all his brushes himself with Lux. Lux detergent. Lux. Only Lux. Didn't want to try anything else. Lux works. So he tried that. That's his studio. Oh, I'm sorry. I better go on. Because I've got to finish this properly. I'll be in trouble. Okay. Oh, you have to go, I know.
I have to go.
That's all right. I just want you to see my favorite.
Oh, okay.
Oh, you better go. This is my favorite. You ready? I love this one, especially being a teacher. I love this one. I save this to last all the time. All the time. And that's Mary Whalen again. The little girl who was looking in the mirror.
Yeah.
There she is. And she is as proud as can be. She won the battle. She's outside the principal's office. But she is happy as can be. I love it. Women's lib. She has band-aids on her knees. Now, the story of the black eye. Oh,
it's okay.
The story of the black eye. She didn't have a black eye. And he wanted a real black eye. So he put an ad in the paper. And a man called up and said, "So you want a kid with a black eye?" And Rockwell said, yes, I do. He said, well, I have 3 kids. I'll get one of them down there. He's going to give his son a black eye and bring him down. So he'd be on the cover of a magazine. And then he got a call from a warden, a prison warden. We just had a battle out there a couple of days ago. We have a lot of guys with black eyes. Reason he got, the only way he got a black eye is one of Norman Rockwell's friends had a son who had a real black eye. So the son came to the studio and Mr. Rockwell painted the black eye and then stuck it, painted it on him. So she didn't have a black eye at all. So imagine a man saying that, oh, I have a couple of kids, I'm give you a black eye. Give you a black eye. All right. Now I gotta show you this. Okay, all right. Okay.
I'll see you guys. Thank you.
Take care. Have a good time.
Thank you.
He's rushing over to an Ogdenessa Community College because they're having the 13 grandmothers.
Yeah. It's already started.
It already started, yeah. And so I give courses over at Northern Essex. I did the Wisdom Keepers. And I just last month I was here, and I did the Wisdom Keepers with the women here, about the Native Americans, going back in time. And next week, I think, the men, for their breakfast, I'm going to do the Wisdom Keepers. But one of the men from Groveland gave me this. Gave me. Bill Forsyth. He, well, I did Norman Rockwell here some time ago, but not like this. And he said, I have something for you. And so you have to come to my house. And I went to his house and we sat there and sat there. Oh boy. It has the pictures of the models and the poses and then the paintings. See, turned her around, so it's this way. Turned around, all of the pictures. It is an awesome book. Look at Norman Rockwell striking up a pose. Look at him, he's down there with skivvies. He wants the model to use this pose for a painting, so he, you know, took off his clothes. And he got up there and I want you to look just like this. He did this all the time for his models. He wanted to have them get the right pose, and he knew what pose to get. Look at that old man. Look at that with the cigar.
Yeah.
So this one shows the photography. Norman Rockwell behind the camera. There's the picture of that. See the picture? There are only three people in the car. And there's the result. There's the result. This book is so awesome. And there's Norman Rockwell with Mary Whalen. He's getting her ready to pose for a painting. He used books behind their shoes so they would have the right pose for their legs. He put books on the floor. There she is. She's standing on a book right there. Then he has the expression on his face, and he wants her to have that expression on her face. Same expression. This man did me such a big favor. Oh boy. Look at this little kid. He had his picture taken.
Oh,
look at his mouth wide open. He's screaming. You see him screaming? Because in the painting, there he is screaming. Christmas time. He put a lot of effort into all of his paintings when you look at things like this. Nope, wait a minute. Oh, the mailman.
Oh, yeah, thanks.
See, he did go with the pictures.
Yeah.
Had to. And it's much faster, too. Much faster than going to pictures. I'm almost finished. I know, because of people. I know. Wait a minute. I have to show you this. Oh, here we go. Here's the real thing.
Oh. Yeah. Uh-huh.
See the Howard Johnson soda jerk?
Yeah.
Here's the real thing. And the state trooper, before he died, said, I know there are stories saying that this was done in such and such a diner in some place. He said it wasn't. And it wasn't done in Howard Johnson's in Pittsfield either. Mm-hmm. Took pictures there, but then he went back and he just turned it into a local diner. Mm-hmm. That's what he did. He put in the backgrounds afterwards. Afterwards, not many artists do that. And there's the real girl and boy getting their wedding license. That's right in Stockbridge, getting their wedding license. Bill Forsythe was so kind to me, and I look at all of, see all of these? I got them all marked. He did me a great favor with this. So I try to show as many people as possible, and I don't want to take it apart. There's even how the pigtails were sticking out in the back. Someone had to hold them. Someone had to hold them out there so he could take a picture of them and then finish it when he painted. Okay? I think I'm okay. Okay. And here's the husband and wife arguing about who to vote for. Who to vote for. One's voting for Dewey and the other one's voting for Truman. The wife is voting for Truman. Sorry. This book is priceless. All right, now, this is the last part. Oh, boy. This is the last part. All these pages. All right. As Mr. Whittier grew older in his late 70s and early 80s, his health and his painting began to weaken. He would lose his balance and fall off the bike. On one occasion, Norman went for a ride on a bike by himself, and he never returned. When he didn't return, his wife Molly went looking for him. She found the bike at the bottom of a ditch. He was sitting on a rock with a confused look on his face. That was the last time Norman went for a bike ride by himself. Near the end of his life, he said, "I get up early every morning. I'm at work by 8. I no longer believe that I'll bring back the golden age of illustration. I realized long ago that I'll never be as good as Rembrandt." But his wonderful touch on his canvases was leaving him, even his mixing of paint colors. In his early 80s, he was suffering from dementia and using a walker. He would ask to be taken to his studio, but he would not paint. He would simply clean his studio over and over and over again, and he would clean his brushes over and over, even though the brushes had not been used. As his autobiography comes to a close, Norman included this. "So, long life to you, gentle readers. The daisies still look better from above than from below." Somebody once said of Picasso, "Of all the paintings you have done, which is your favorite?" "The next one." And so it was with Rockwell. Rockwell went on, "I have 7 ads waiting in the drawer. The canvas for the mural is hanging in the ice house. Sketches for covers are lined up on my print shelf. I guess I'd better get back to work." But he wasn't doing any work. On Wednesday night, November 8, 1978, Norman Rockwell died at home in Stockbridge. The cause of death was listed as emphysema. It was the passing of a national treasure. He was almost 85 years old. I could keep you here until after supper if you want to.